The Lost Choice, A Legend of Personal Discovery by Andy Andrews. This audio version is published by Oasis Audio through an agreement with Nelson Books, a division of Thomas Nelson Incorporated. The Lost Choice is read by Andy Andrews.
Prologue. Sinai Peninsula, 281 AD. Casimir shielded his eyes with both hands as he peered intently into the sun's last rays. Another tear made a track through the dust in his browned face and fell from his chin. His age was 11 summers now, almost a man, and his father's falcon was missing. Elim, his father, had often made it clear he was not yet ready to command the valuable huntress. The falcon had been a gift from a prince, given to Elim as a sign of respect. Her name was Ski, a word the prince had told him meant swift. She was as tall as Casimir's arm was long, and her talons completely enveloped the leather covering on his skinny shoulder where she sometimes sat as Casimir rode his father's camel. Ski was snow-white with jet-black slashes in her feathers, and she wore a hood that matched the Jess's, long hide straps on her legs. Intending to prove his resourcefulness and maturity, the boy had impulsively released the bird earlier in the day when the shadows were small. Food was scarce, and the rabbit he had glimpsed would have made an excellent meal. Unfortunately, the beautiful falcon had not seen fit to return with the rabbit, or any rabbit, or to return at all for that matter. "Cassie!" The boy cringed at the sound of his father's voice. It was not an unkind voice, for he was not an unkind man. It was, however, the voice of a man who demanded honesty, and Casimir would be honest with him now. "Cassie!" Elim called again. "Coming, father." The desert glowed with the approaching dusk as the velvet sand returned its heat to the evening sky. For 3 days the Bedouins had rested at Elim. Fewer than 50, 100 men, women, and children comprised this nomadic group, generally wandering an area between the springs of Marah and a mountain they called Jabal al-Laws. These people did not count Elim and his son as part of their tribe. Neither, however, did they consider them intruders. Elim and Cassie had come and gone several times over the last 4 summers, each arrival bringing news of interest from Egypt, Midian, even Rome. Their story was known to all. Elim's wife had died when Cassie was still a baby. He never took another woman, choosing instead to care for his boy alone and live a life wandering among the wanderers. It was incredibly dangerous. There were slave traders, thieves, and of course the desert itself. Yet season after season, the father and son traveled together, sometimes with one tribe or another, but most often alone. Elim was regarded as very unique among the desert people for 2 reasons. One, he had a gift of clarity. Many said he could see through a head directly into a heart. Elim was not a prophet or a religious leader and almost never addressed a gathering, but was often sought as a companion by the fire or as the caravan moved across the sand. He spoke directly, but with compassion, discerning one's past with an eye to guiding the future. Elim was an oracle of truth. Second, it was widely known that Elim had a possession. Beyond one's camel, robes, and perhaps a weapon such as a sword or even a falcon or sighthound, this was almost unheard of. But Elim had one, a possession, and no one had any idea what it was. Elim's possession was rolled thickly in burgundy linen and bound with cord cut from a black burnous. A short leather strap wound tightly around Elim's left shoulder and neck, allowing the object to settle into the folds of his robe. Thus, it was carried next to his chest, where his eyes could watch the possession and his arms could protect it, always and all the time. Elim slept, ate, and traveled with the possession awkwardly attached to him. It was of an indeterminate size due to the bulky cloth in which it was wrapped, but a bit smaller than the foot of a camel had been accepted as the general dimension by those who engaged in endless discussions about this curiosity. It was whispered that even Casimir, his boy, had never seen the item. Cassie found his father seated alone, cross-legged, beside a small fire, one of many burning throughout the palms. "Ah, there you are, my son," Elim said as the boy entered the firelight.
"Father, I have something to tell you, he began right away. And I am anxious to hear your news, Salem said with a smile. But first, be seated and partake of today's abundance, for soon today will be gone. Eat.
Father, what I have to say
will wait until you have eaten. Sit, my son. He gestured toward the ground to his right. As Cassie sat beside him, Elam continued. We will depart this evening. Are you hungry?
Yes, father.
Then eat. Elam pulled a stick from over the fire and removed the leg of what appeared to be a large roasted hare. He brushed a cinder from the meat with his free hand, passed it to Cassie, and said, A small band of us, perhaps a half a score, will move north when the fires are low. Will you halt her, Biba, when you are through here? She is with a group of camels under the fig tree.
As you wish, father, but first I must tell you,
Cassie.
Yes, father?
Eat.
Yes, father.
Casimir took a big bite and chewed thoughtfully as he studied the man everyone said he so closely resembled. His father's black hair barely showed around the edges of what was once a white burnous. His skin was dark, burned to an even shade by the sun and wind, and it contrasted sharply with his even white teeth. His nose was long and straight, perfect except for the small scar running across the bridge, and his chin was strong. One could easily see Elim's chin, for his beard had never grown. More stubble than beard, the whiskers were short and thinly spaced. The boy smiled at his father as he took another bite. No one looks at his beard anyway, he thought. They only see his eyes. It was true. Elim's eyes were bright blue, as rare as diamonds, Cassie had heard the women say. He had seen men avert their own eyes when they met his father.
Blue eyes, Cassie mused. Blue eyes like azure, and I have them too.
Suddenly, Cassie frowned.
Is this rabbit, father?
He held up a bone from which he had eaten the meat.
Rabbit, hare.
Yes. Elim's eyebrows lifted.
From where did we receive such a blessing?
Well, let me see.
Elim rubbed his finger alongside his nose.
Could it have been a gift from another family?
No, father, there's not been enough to eat, much less to share.
Yes, I see what you mean, Elim said, smiling. No, it would have not been a gift, and we know what the dogs do if they catch one. No sharing there. Do you suppose perhaps Biba ran this one down?
Cassie laughed. He was being teased, and he knew it. No, father, I don't believe our grouchy old camel caught a rabbit, but I've never seen you run fast enough to catch one either.
That is very true, my son. I'm not as fleet as the hare.
Elim quickly put his arm around Cassie and lay straight back, pulling the boy with him until both were side by side, flat on their backs, looking upward. He pointed with the bone in his hand, directing his son's gaze to a palm branch above them.
No, I am not as fast as a rabbit, but I do enjoy its taste, and that is why I take care of my falcon.
Ski! Cassie exclaimed.
The beautiful bird sat above them, cocking her head curiously. Turning, he said,
Where did you find her? I was about to tell you she was lost and that it was all my fault.
She found me, Cassie, with the rabbit only moments after you let her go.
Elim narrowed his eyes a bit and smiled. And while yet another conversation remains about you and Ski, I must admit pride that you were willing to accept responsibility for the disobedient choice you made. That is evidence of a growing character.
Cassie rolled over and moved into a sitting position, as Elim stood and began wrapping the folds of his burnous around his left arm.
I want to do what is right, the boy said, but sometimes I want to do what I...
He paused and furrowed his brow. Then looking up at his father, he stumbled ahead.
Well, I suppose I want to do what I want to do. Is that evidence of a bad character?
Elim smiled at Cassie and extended his arm toward the falcon.
Your character is your essence. It is what you are. Your character is determined by the choices you make when no one will ever know what you did or didn't do.
Ski dropped from the palm branch and landed heavily on Alim's arm.
You must build your character daily, my son, and immediately. All blossoms of tomorrow and all weeds as well are in the seeds you are sowing today. Your influence, your wealth, and ultimately your legacy will be decided by this one thing. For ultimately, no person can ever rise beyond the restrictions of his own character.
For a moment, the man and boy simply looked at each other, blue eyes burning blue eyes into memory by firelight.
Cassie spoke first. "I understand," he said. "I knew you would," his father responded softly. Then, slipping into the shadows, he said, "Quickly now, ready the camel." The darkness was vast and complete, the moonless night, a flowing tide of ebony muslin drawn like a tent over the tiny caravan. 8 camels plodded in a loosely defined single file, gradually gaining ground.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.